Recorded Books presents No Ordinary Thing by G.Z. Schmidt, narrated by Kurt Kanazawa. Chapter 1. New York City, 1999. About 2 hours before midnight, on a busy street in Manhattan, a man in a raincoat appeared out of nowhere. His sudden presence should have been startling, but no one took notice of him. That particular part of New York bustled with cars and people at all hours, so much so that nobody really saw each other in the crowds. Everyone had other business to attend to, and a stranger lingering in the shadows, even one who had quite literally materialized from thin air, did not capture their interest that October evening. The man in the raincoat walked several blocks until the path broke off to reveal a cobblestone side street leading to a quieter patch of neighborhood. He stood at its edge and silently observed the area with a smile. If anyone had bothered to take a glance at him that night, they might have found it slightly odd that the man's raincoat was dripping wet when it hadn't rained anywhere nearby that day. They might have found it odder still that he carried what looked like a snow globe in his hands, with the care of someone cradling a cherished pet. But New York City was full of oddballs, so again, no one bothered with him. Which is unfortunate, because had these passers-by stopped to ask who he was and what he was doing there, they would have found the answer the oddest of all. Because our friend in the raincoat wasn't supposed to exist yet. Chapter 2. The Visitor in the Raincoat. The same cobblestone street had a tiny bakery on the corner called the Biscuit Basket. Ask anyone in the neighborhood and they would tell you the Biscuit Basket was a perfectly adequate bakery, now please get out of my way, which was a sore understatement, because the bakery's goods were far above average. In the early mornings, when the sun had barely tinted the glassy skyscrapers along the East River, the aroma of freshly baked breads and chocolate croissants wafted from the tiny brick building and filled every inch of the street. Despite its enticing smells and first-rate offerings, however, the bakery had only a scarcely adequate share of customers. On good days, morning saw one or two adults who stopped by for a quick sugar donut before work. In the afternoons came the neighborhood kids fresh from school, their pockets jingling with allowance money as they gathered around the colorful array of cupcakes along the counter. And of course, there were the occasional weary ladies in large, fancy hats who needed 2 orders of peach cobbler, immediately if you please, for their evening book club every third Tuesday of the month. But on bad days, the Biscuit Basket had hardly any visitors at all. On those days, the baker, a stocky and balding man named Henry, could be seen waiting behind the counter anxiously, or else rearranging the cakes at the display window for the 1,000th time, or else trying to attract customers by offering free samples of strawberry and almond tarts to passers-by. It wasn't Henry's fault. No matter how hard he pounded the dough, no matter how fast he mixed the cream and sugar, the Biscuit Basket never seemed to entice quite enough customers to its corner of the street. Not when an enormous candy shop, a coffee shop, and 2 other bakeries sat just 2 streets over. So on those lonely days, Henry would look wistfully at the untouched pastries that had grown stale and hope he had enough money to pay the rent. It was such a day on that Saturday evening when our story begins. A few hours before the mysterious man in the raincoat appeared, the streets were cold and dreary and darkening with October gloom. Not a single customer had stopped by the bakery, where Henry had sat behind the counter for the better part of the day. Finally, it was closing time. Henry sighed and looked up from the dollar bills he was counting. Money had been tight that week, as always, but at least this time he could afford to donate most of the leftovers instead of saving them for the next day's discount shelf. Baked goods are never as tasty the day after.
"Adam,"
the baker called to his nephew. Do you mind delivering the leftover breakfast pastries to the hole? Henry had one helper in the shop, his 12-year-old nephew, Adam. Adam was small for his age, with pale skin and eyes the color of charcoal. One could occasionally glimpse the top of the boy's tousled dark hair behind the kitchen window, or if you were to watch carefully, you might see him slip your order of lemon custard on the counter before disappearing to the back without a peep. Because of his uncle's job, Adam spent his time either at school or at the bakery. Adam didn't mind. He didn't have too many friends. Adam was, by all accounts, a peculiar boy. But we shall get to that later. Sure, Uncle Henry, Adam answered. He closed the pages of Self-Guide to Caring for Mice he was reading and collected the unsold pastries from that day into a large paper bag. He lugged the bag outside. The stars were hidden in the cloudy night sky, the moon barely visible. Adam cautiously made his way down the sidewalk, taking care to stay in the parts lit by streetlights as he approached the hole. Most things don't belong in holes. Holes are damp and dark, and ideal for dog bones, trash, and pesky night critters that dig up people's vegetable gardens. In the same way, the hole was what most people called the local homeless shelter, and with it, the city's unwanted inhabitants. As usual, the hole's tired brick walls and murky windows greeted Adam. Several disheveled folks stood outside the scratched door, their worn faces half hidden in the shadows, their hands stuffed in their pockets. None of them seemed to have smiled in a long time. Adam sometimes wondered if they'd forgotten how. He passed them silently and went inside the battered building to the kitchen. A skinny, elderly man in a wheelchair sat stirring a large pot of what smelled like cabbage stew. Upon hearing Adam's footsteps, he turned his tanned and weathered face to the boy and broke into a nearly toothless grin.
"Hello, fellow," said the old man.
"Hi, Victor. Special delivery," Adam murmured. He placed the bag of muffins and croissants in the man's outstretched hands. "Extras from today." Victor was a resident of the homeless shelter. He spent his mornings on the streets, chatting with the other homeless folks or telling entertaining tales to children. He spent his evenings cooking for the hungry. Victor was one of the few people Adam didn't mind talking to. The old man never made fun of Adam for his eyes or size. Victor gratefully took the pastries and held the bag close to his scruffy beard.
"They smell wonderful,"
he sighed, and put the crinkled bag in the basket attached to his wheelchair. Rumor had it that he lost his leg in a street fight against a bulldog. Or was it an alligator? Victor changed the story every time he told it. Adam mumbled something in reply. Victor leaned forward with his ear cupped.
"Sorry, sonny, my hearing isn't as good as it once was,"
the 12-year-old said louder. "There's a blueberry muffin in there. Your favorite."
"Excellent! I'll make sure to save that for myself. Did you know, just this morning, I met a lady who grows blueberries for a living? Right in a little garden on the roof of her apartment building. Just imagine the mathematical probability of a blueberry patch's existence on a rooftop like that."
Normally, Adam would stay longer to listen to Victor recount his day's adventures and conversations. The old man had a way of telling stories that instantly captivated listeners, even if the story was about something as simple as going to the grocery store for milk. But that evening, something particular was weighing on Adam's mind, and he itched to return home as soon as possible. Victor seemed to read his thoughts.
"How is Speedy?" the old man asked.
Speedy was Adam's pet mouse, rescued from the confines of the biscuit basket's kitchen cabinet one fateful evening 2 months ago. Uncle Henry had been preparing a batch of vanilla cupcakes and was searching the cabinet for a box of rainbow sprinkles when the white mouse peeked out from behind a jar of flour. Before Uncle Henry could react, the mouse had zoomed down the baker's outstretched arm onto the counter. Uncle Henry, who liked rodents as much as he liked moldy cupcakes, didn't hesitate to grab his bread knife. It was Adam's dismayed, "Wait, don't hurt it!" that stopped what would have been a disastrous evening for Speedy. Speedy was a big reason Adam didn't need friends at school. The mouse did what any boy could do: eat, run, sleep, listen. What's more, Speedy could do tricks. He could climb onto Adam's hand when his name was called and wiggle his pink nose and soft whiskers against Adam's fingers. He could stand up on his tiny hind legs when directed. He had once even crawled across a pencil Adam held in midair. Adam was very fond of the deer mouse, though he wisely avoided letting Uncle Henry know he'd adopted it. "Speedy's fine," Adam avoided Victor's eyes and cleared the catch in his throat. "I have to get back home. See you later."
"Goodbye! Say hello to your uncle for me."
Adam and his uncle lived in the small apartment above the biscuit basket. It had one bedroom the size of a normal closet, a narrow kitchen, a tight bathroom, and a living room that might have been spacious had it not doubled as Uncle Henry's bedroom and a storage space for baking utensils. The one good thing about a cramped apartment above a bakery was that every nook and cranny smelled of baked goods. After returning home, Adam raced to his bedroom. He stepped over the animal care brochures and half-finished library books he'd borrowed and reached under his narrow mattress to retrieve the old shoebox where Speedy slept. He gently prodded the white mouse, but it didn't budge. The mouse hadn't moved in a day, and its breaths were faint.
"Come on, buddy," Adam whispered. "I brought you something."
He placed a smashed blueberry inside the box next to Speedy. Blueberries, according to Self-Guide to Caring for Mice, had antioxidants, nutritious energy that supposedly boosted the body. It should make Speedy move again. Adam waited, but nothing happened.
"Adam?"
Uncle Henry peered inside the room. Adam shoved the box behind him, but not before his uncle had caught a glimpse. His uncle sighed.
"Adam, we've talked about this," he said. "Mice are not household pets."
"I know."
"They spoil the flour and ruin everything.
Not Speedy. He only eats the lettuce and fruits I feed him."
Uncle Henry gave another sigh and shook his head. Some people said the baker looked just like Adam's father. This made sense, since siblings tend to look alike. Although from what Adam could remember, his father had been leaner and taller, with fair hair and tanner skin, whereas Uncle Henry stayed pale from a lack of sunlight due to working many hours indoors. Adam took after his mother more, who had dark hair like Adam, and had also been short for her age. Uncle Henry opened his mouth to say something, likely a lecture about how mice are the reason exterminators have secure jobs, but before he could launch into his spiel, the doorbell chimed downstairs. Adam and his uncle exchanged a puzzled look. The bakery was closed.
"It's probably the landlord," said Uncle Henry with a slightly worried expression.
Adam followed his uncle downstairs. Visits from the dreaded landlord, especially at night, were never a good sign. The last time the landlord had arrived, Uncle Henry had gotten a warning letter for being late on the rent. It was not the landlord. Instead, a cheerful stranger in a raincoat stood outside the door, waving to Adam and his uncle through the glass. He held a map in one hand and ran his other hand through his wet, graying, wheat-colored hair.
"I'm terribly sorry. I know it's late," the man called through the door. "But I was passing by and, well, may I say your cakes look fabulous? I simply must buy one, or five. I hope you're not closed."
After the long, empty day of no customers, Uncle Henry was so giddy at the potential business that he threw open the door and practically kissed the stranger's hand. The stranger had barely finished introducing himself as J.C. Walsh before the baker started speaking a mile a minute about the goods available.
"We have every kind of cake imaginable," said Uncle Henry. "Carrot cake, coffee cake, a red velvet cake that I can frost for you right now with the most scrumptious whipped cream you've ever tasted."
"Excellent," said the man in the raincoat.
I'll have that red velvet cake, please. Then he added, make it with buttercream frosting, my favorite, and I'll pay double what you'd normally charge.
This was more than Uncle Henry could bear.
He stammered a, yes, of course, and stumbled into the kitchen in a daze.
There followed a clanging of pots and bowls, and the sound of Uncle Henry's humming was soon accompanied by the soothing whir of the mixer. Adam was about to head back upstairs when, to his surprise, the man in the raincoat turned to address him.
You must be Adam Lee Tripp.
Growing up in a city as large as New York had taught Adam not to share personal information with strangers. He didn't answer, but stared blankly at the man, who stared back with a big smile.
It's been a while, said the stranger, his voice softening.
The man reached into his pocket and held up a snow globe. Inside the glass sphere was a miniature cityscape that looked just like Manhattan, sprinkled with bright snow confetti. The man gazed at the snow globe in a sort of admiration. The one in which past days unfold, he murmured. Then, as if he suddenly remembered Adam was there, he raised his head and said, Speedy is sick and dying, but great things are in store for you. Adam gaped at the man. He had no idea how the stranger knew about Speedy. Could he be a fortune teller? Adam wondered. Uncle Henry always said that fortune tellers were con artists wrapped in glitzy shawls who charged $20 per reading and whose predictions were most of the time as wrong as two left feet.
Speedy's not dead yet, Adam said hoarsely, but he said it so quietly he doubted the man heard. Hear me, Adam?
The man persisted. Great things await you. Fantastic things. You will find new friends in new places and go on journeys more magical than you could have ever imagined. From the kitchen in the back, Uncle Henry shouted,
Do you want fondant roses on the cake?
Yes, that would be delightful,
the man in the raincoat called back. He put the snow globe back in his pocket and winked at Adam. Tonight, go up to the attic, he instructed with a mysterious smile. Your adventures await you there. Adam decided this character was not to be trusted.
Okay, sir, he said, taking a step back. Bye.
He ran upstairs before the man could say another word. As soon as Adam was alone, he checked on Speedy again. The blueberry lay untouched. The mouse still didn't move. Adam felt sick, his throat burning. He gently placed the cardboard box back under the bed. He then angrily kicked his copy of Self-Guide to Caring for Mice across the floor before crawling under the covers and turning off the lights. He spent a long time thinking about the man in the raincoat. The stranger was a weirdo. He'd known it as soon as the man said Adam's name. And then the man mentioned the attic, of all places, which was by far Adam's least favorite room in the building. It was a long time before he finally drifted uncomfortably to sleep. Little did Adam know, the stranger was right. Things were about to change in ways he couldn't begin to imagine.
Chapter 3. A Trip to the Attic. Earlier, I mentioned that Adam was a peculiar boy. Adam is a good student, wrote his sixth grade teacher, Ms. Basil, on his first report card of the year. But he never interacts with his peers. The year before that, his fifth grade teacher, Mr. Lemon, observed, Adam sits by himself at recess and reads the entire time, every single day. And the year before that, Mrs. Rosemary, Adam's fourth grade teacher, noted,
Adam has not spoken a single word this entire year in class other than to mumble requests to use the restroom.
Ever since kindergarten, Adam had kept his distance from other kids. In the classroom, he'd always pick the farthest seat possible from everyone else. He sat by himself at lunchtime. At recess, whenever someone asked him to join in a game, be it hide and seek, hopscotch, or freeze tag, he would adamantly shake his head. He kept himself inside an invisible cocoon, the way a caterpillar hides from the outside world. The thing about isolating yourself is that once you do it often enough, people tend to avoid you in return. Eventually, kids started making up nasty rumors about Adam. Nicknames, too. His belongings started vanishing and turning up in the bathroom toilets. In sixth grade, a few classmates had taken up the hobby of shoving him into the school lockers whenever they had the chance. Unfortunately for them, Adam was as nimble as he was invisible, and he usually managed to stay out of the bully's way. The school counselor, Ms. Ginger, believed there was an easy solution to every problem. A fierce woman with fiery red hair, she frequently assessed Adam's shyness and did not hesitate to offer Uncle Henry her unyielding opinion. As a professionally licensed counselor, I recommend Adam join an after-school club so he can meet children with similar interests. I myself am an honorary member of the Amateur Actors Association. We have our first musical this summer, by the way. I'll be playing the mermaid in the second act. Please remember to book tickets in advance. Anyway, I know firsthand how wonderful after-school activities can be. Boy Scouts, for example, is a great way to build character. Just ask my darling sons. Did you know my eldest earned his second merit badge last month? Very proud of him. Not to mention the splendid troop uniforms. But after-school activities meant spare time and money, neither of which Adam or his uncle had. So Adam did not wear a splendid uniform, but instead wore secondhand clothes from thrift stores. Uncle Henry owned neither a car nor a TV. At least they never went hungry. Uncle Henry would make his own breads and pasta, since it was significantly cheaper than buying from the grocery store. They'd often finish leftover items from the bakery, soaking them in watery soup so the bread wouldn't taste stale. Adam understood his uncle was poor and tried to help out whenever he could. He was fine with not getting an allowance like the other kids. On his last birthday, he didn't complain when he received not a single present, much less the red 7-speed bicycle he'd been eyeing for months in the bike shop's window. He skipped the bookstores and borrowed books for free from the public library. The one downside to that was all the fill-in-the-blank adventure stories and crossword puzzles tended to be scribbled in already. It helped that Uncle Henry was one of the best bakers around, even if not enough people seemed to know it. Adam may have had to ignore the dollar ice cream line in the school cafeteria, but he had plenty of delicious sweets to come home to. No, despite his financial situation, despite avoiding people in the school hallways, Adam was not a mean kid. You probably already guessed that when you learned how Adam spared Speedy's life in the kitchen. Ultimately, however, he couldn't save the mouse, just like he couldn't save his parents. The first instance of loss, while tragic, was not peculiar. Although Adam didn't know it, Speedy was already 1.5 years old when rescued, and mice typically don't live longer than 2 years. As for his parents' accident, there was no way Adam could have prevented that disaster. But we are getting ahead of ourselves. About a week after the strange man in the raincoat visited the bakery, Uncle Henry broke the news to Adam. They were short on rent that month. "There's old stuff in our attic that we don't need anymore," said his uncle, avoiding eye contact. "If you wouldn't mind picking out some things after breakfast, I can sell them to the pawn shop later." He trailed off uncomfortably. Adam nibbled the last bit of his toast and nodded reluctantly. The tiny storage space was dusty, stuffy, and home to dozens of crawling spiders and other abominations with more than 6 legs. Adam wasn't afraid of bugs, but he hated when they appeared out of nowhere. He hated when anything appeared out of nowhere. After breakfast, he climbed the ladder in their apartment that led to the attic. Forgotten boxes and broken suitcases lay scattered across the creaky floorboards. Adam made his way across the room, guided by a shaft of muted white sunlight that streamed through a small circular window. After half an hour of searching, he set aside several promising items that he suspected would sell for a decent amount of money, mostly things like candelabras, extra silverware, old curtains, and rusty tools. Then, inevitably, one of the boxes in the corner caught his attention. The cardboard was worn, and the handwritten label on the box had faded, but one could still make out the familiar name, Trip. Adam's heart raced. That particular box was one he had gone through only a few times in his life, and for good reason. Today, though, he felt drawn to open it. A stale cloud of dust greeted him as he carefully lifted the lid. His parents, international aid workers and avid travelers, had owned a large collection of paper maps and atlases. From what Adam knew, they'd been part of an explorer's club of some sort. Several of the maps and thick books sat in the box, nested among souvenirs from all over the world. Adam picked up a carved wooden seashell from when his parents had visited the shores of Brazil. Beneath that was a volcanic rock from Hawaii, the jagged piece of earth looking more like a black, deformed kitchen sponge. His parents had reportedly climbed an extinct volcano when they visited the tropical island. Snuggled against the rock was a smiling porcelain cat with Chinese symbols painted on its body, one of his mother's heirlooms from her birthplace. He dug past a few more miscellaneous items, setting them on the floor beside him, keychains, plastic cups with faraway city names printed on them in shiny block letters, bead bracelets, an antique admission ticket to a carnival in New Jersey, until he found the faded postcard. His parents had sent it from Norway, just a few days before the accident. Like the box, the edges of the postcard were frayed, and the ink had smeared in some places, but Adam already knew the message by heart. "Dear Adam, hello from Norway. We hope all is well back home. Uncle Henry left us a message at our hotel to tell us you won second place in the kindergarten egg and spoon race derby. We're so proud of you. We miss you and can't wait to be back next Tuesday. Someday when you're older, we'll take you on these trips with us. Soon you'll be as tired of airplanes as we are, though they're certainly more ordinary and predictable than other forms of travel, shall we say? No matter where or when or how, we want to do all the good we can in the world. It's such a big, amazing place full of wonders, and you never know which of these wonders are in store for you or what you might find. Love, Mom and Dad." Adam would never sell any of his parents' personal belongings, of course. But neither did he like to look at them for too long. He started to place the postcard back in the box. Then he did a double take. Underneath the postcard, wedged next to an atlas, was a snow globe. Adam vaguely remembered seeing it displayed on the topmost shelf of his parents' bookcase in their old apartment. The snow globe looked like an ordinary snow globe, the glass sphere a little bigger than a grapefruit and glued onto a square wooden base. However, unlike most snow globes, the inside of the glass was clear and blank. It contained only a layer of confetti snow, nothing else. On the corner of the base was a small engraving of a compass rose. Adam remembered the uncanny stranger in the raincoat who had shown up with his own snow globe a week ago. "Go up to the attic," he had instructed Adam. "Nonsense," Adam fumed. "It doesn't mean anything. The man was a lunatic." He was bitter at himself for even thinking of the man in the raincoat, who had correctly guessed Speedy was about to die. Earlier that week, Uncle Henry had prepared an empty egg carton for Speedy's funeral. "A dead mouse can't feel the cold," his uncle had said, in a failed attempt to comfort him. They'd buried the mouse in the dumpster out back, since they didn't have a yard. Adam placed the rest of his parents' keepsakes back inside the box. He gathered the tools, candelabra, and old curtains he'd found for Uncle Henry into a duffel bag, slung the strap over his shoulder, and started to climb back down the ladder. But then, for some reason he couldn't explain, Adam stopped. He set down his bundle and went back to his parents' box. The next time he made his way to the ladder, he had the snow globe with him. Downstairs, the bakery was devoid of customers. Adam placed the bag of items from the attic on the counter, right above the untouched rows of breakfast pastries that were slowly going stale. Uncle Henry was in the kitchen. "Did you find anything?" he called through the window, to which Adam held up the candelabra in reply. His uncle came over with a batch of mouse-shaped frosted sugar cookies. "Here, I made these for you. You've been glum all week." Adam knew they were meant to cheer him up about Speedy. For his uncle's sake, he pretended to enjoy a piece of mouse tail, even though he didn't feel like eating anything. They chewed in silence. His uncle cleared the plates. "All right, I'm heading out," said Uncle Henry. He hung the closed sign on the bakery door, then picked up the bag of items Adam had gathered. "This is everything, right?" "Wait!" Adam jumped up and removed the snow globe from the duffel. "Not this." He placed the snow globe on the counter. After Uncle Henry left, Adam went back to his cramped bedroom. There wasn't a lot to do at home, especially now that he no longer spent his free time teaching Speedy new tricks. He sat for a while and tried to read the new book he'd borrowed from the library, but there was a paragraph about talking mice, so he tossed that aside. He doodled on a piece of paper, but soon his circles and zigzags connected into a head and then into the body of a cartoon mouse, as if his hand had a mind of its own. In frustration, he crumpled up the paper. Adam didn't like to admit it, but in particularly lonely moments like this, he wished he had at least one friend. A friend who was a real person, just like him. Someone to swap stories and joke with, the way other sixth graders did. He sat in his room until the empty silence, without the usual scratching noises Speedy made, became unbearable. He shuffled back downstairs, looking for something to distract himself. Outside, the early afternoon sun hung lazily behind puffy autumn clouds. The first brittle leaves had begun to litter the sidewalk. Adam decided to sweep the leaves from the front of the store, a boring task, but his uncle would appreciate it. First, though, a quick snack. The croissants behind the counter still looked fresh enough. Adam started to reach for one with raspberry jelly. He halted. On the counter, the snow globe had changed. The glass dome was no longer empty, but contained a tiny, snow-covered city. Adam examined the snow globe. The cityscape within looked just like New York. He thought of J.C. Walsh's snow globe again. Great things await you. Fantastic things. Adam batted away the voice. He carefully inspected the snow globe again. It still looked like an ordinary snow globe, the kind sold in toy stores or tourist shops. Adam shrugged and gave it a shake. Sparkling snow confetti swirled inside the glass. Then a single, real snowflake landed on the back of Adam's hand. Chapter 4. An Unexpected Holiday. Adam now stood in the middle of a busy, snow-covered sidewalk. Around him, snowflakes fell steadily between enormous flashing neon signs and glittering buildings.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.